bowlers in the world have converged on the Great Northwest, and they are live this evening from Skyway Park Bowl in Seattle, Washington, for the finals of the $125,000 Columbia 300 Open. Hello, everybody. I'm Denny Schreiner, along with 14-time PBA champion Mike Durbin. We are here in Seattle, and Mike, once again, you find the resurgence of the left-handers on the telecast this week.
You're absolutely right, Denny. We have the top three spots are occupied by left-handed bowlers this week. The last time that happened on the PBA Tour was in 1986 in Peoria, Illinois, in the True Value Tournament, when we had Steve Cook, John Gant, and Hugh Miller as the top three seeds. However, interestingly enough, Denny, that tournament was won by a right-hander, Walter Ray Williams.
Ah, Walter Ray Williams. Now let's assess the field for tonight's championship. Speaking of great right-handers, how about number five, Mark Roth?
Mark Roth, the man with the big, powerful bowling ball, won 32 PBA tournaments. However, it's been 2.5 years since he last won, so we're going to see tonight whether he can get that monkey off his back and win title number 33.
And Mark will be tested by a very talented right-hander, Mike Jasnau.
Two-time All-American from Wichita State, had the highest average on the television pair. He averaged a whopping 267 for two games on this pair.
The most consistent player of the week was Scott Devers. He is slotted number three.
A young player, left-handed player from Centerville, Indiana, has a very unusual style. However, he was probably the most steady of all of our performers this week. Needs to win three games tonight to win his first PBA title.
And the wily veteran, Bobby Jacks, in the number two spot.
Last won his first tournament and his third tournament 21 years ago. He won three titles in his first year on the tour. Hasn't won since. If he could win now, that would be a long drought ended.
And for the first time in his career, Parker Bohn III is the top seed player.
Some people on the PBA Tour think Parker is the best left-hander on the PBA Tour right now. We're going to find out what is in his heart tonight, whether he can come out and win one game tonight and win the Columbia-Seattle Open.
I was just going to say, Mike, bowling from the top seed spot for the first time in his career, you did that. How much pressure is that on a young player?
I think it's a lot of pressure on a young player. However, I won my first PBA title bowling from the top spot in Tampa, Florida, back in 1967. So this is 1987. Maybe Parker Bohn can win his first PBA title from the top spot tonight.
Well, we've got a terrific field and the opening match just coming up in a moment or so. So stay tuned to ESPN for the PBA Summer Tour. Telecast is being brought to you by Budweiser, Beechwood Age, for that distinctively clean, crisp taste that makes Budweiser the king of beers. For all that you do, this Bud's for you. By True Value Hardware, more than just a name, it's their way of doing business. And by McDonald's, it's a good time for the great taste of McDonald's. Coming up next, maybe the greatest right-hander of all time, Mark Roth, and he'll test his talents against a third-year pro, Mike Jasnau.
Be right back, Pop.
This Bud's for all that you do.
Hey, Pete, come here. Miss you?
Hey, my glove.
I found out Pop worked overtime to pay for it. He was always knocking himself out to give us something better.
Sounds a lot like you.
Budweiser, the king of beers,
hey, Pop,
salutes everyone who's ever worked for more than just a paycheck.
Thanks. I think that's my line.
This Bud's for you.
Cleaning is easy with help from True Value Hardware Stores. The Turbo Wash Power Pressure Sprayer generates a dirt-cutting spray of water and suds to clean your car, driveway, windows, and screens. It's just $14.99 less a $5 Turbo Wash rebate. An Armor-All protectant beautifies leather, vinyl, rubber, and plastic surfaces. The 16-ounce trigger spray bottle is just $3.99, less a $1 Armor-All rebate. Make cleaning easy with help from participating True Value Hardware stores and home centers.
McDonald's is tossing salad with turkey and ham. It's new.
Chef salad. We're tossing salad fresh all day.
It's a meal.
It's a big new taste. It's a new chef salad.
Tossed fresh to go anywhere you want to have it.
It's a good time for the great taste. New chef salad.
I'm McDonald's.
I'd no sooner settle for a flake in my hair than a spot on my uniform.
You pass the test. Your good grooming has the look of success. Your hair.
Shoulders above the rest.
Regular shampoos just rinse flakes. Head and Shoulders goes to the source to help stop flakes.
And that's doing it right.
Your Head and Shoulders above the rest.
Welcome back to Skyway Park Bowl in Seattle, Washington. There you see the handshake between Mark Roth and Mike Jasnau. And Mark Roth will start on the left-hand lane, Mike Durbin. And Mark said the lanes are hooking just a touch more than they were throughout the week.
Lanes 33 and 4 here at the Skyway Park Bowl. And lane 34 hooks more than 33. I think it's going to be the key lane tonight, at least for the right-handers. Right out with a 10-pin, first shot.
Interestingly enough, I chatted with Mark before the telecast this evening, Mike. He said, Denny, I'm going with the ball. I've had some hand problems. I'm very sore at this point. I'm going with the ball. I know I can get out of, and I know I can hit the pocket with. Now, I may leave some 10 pins, but I'm going to take that chance.
Well, he's going with a conservative approach, which is normally not Mark Roth's style.
Do you think perhaps that's a reflection of age and experience, Mike Durbin?
Well, it also might be a reflection not only of age and experience, but maybe he anticipates the scores being around the 2-0 to 2-10 area tonight and figures that he can get that much and win some games.
And your first look at 25-year-old Mike Jasnau, two-time All-American at Wichita State.
And that's how he averaged 267 on this pair. Interestingly enough, Dan, as he was warming up, I said, well, what was the secret that you bowled so well on this pair? And he said, well, I switched to a different ball last night that went straighter, and it just kind of held into the pocket. And I said, well, are you going to use that ball tonight? And he said, no, I'm not. And then he switched back again, and he's using that ball right now. Mm-hmm. He changed it the last part of the practice session.
Shot games of 255 and 279 on the championship pair during match play competition. Looking for the double.
Perfect, and leaves a solid nine. What a bad break for Mike Jasnau.
Just to give you an idea, he's seen that nine pin before, Mike Durbin, during the 279 game. It was a solid nine pin in the seventh that stopped him from the perfect game.
And there we see he averaged 211 in 1987. He's 25 years old, just a youngster. Cross lane at the nine pin. No trouble. Mike Jasnow's style right here. Watch his swing. Four steps, and his swing kind of comes behind the hip. Now watch the follow-through. Right there behind the hip. The follow-through goes, kind of fought to get out of that ball a little bit, but right out toward the target. Roth hooking the ball a little bit more. And gets the message.
Is that the head pin, Mike, most of the time, the messenger pin?
Definitely. Most of the time, that's the head pin that goes to the sideboard and comes across to get that 10 pin.
Mark Roth with career earnings in excess of $1,225,000. And there you see his numbers for the week. And that's how Mark, through the years, has made all that money. He's had a big average.
2.5 years since he last won for the double.
He is very hungry, Mike, in talking to him before this show. And he said, Denny, you know, I have really bowled pretty good the last couple of years on television. Just haven't been able to get a break. Maybe tonight will be the night.
Well, Jasnau bowling, almost a legend in Mark Roth. Has to be a little bit intimidating to him.
Is that worth a couple of sticks here and there, do you think, Mike?
Well, right away, it's worth a 4-7-10 right now. Is it right lane? Again, we talked about hooking more than the left lane and being the key lane tonight.
It appeared as if Jasnau didn't rear at the line but didn't quite stay down and threw the shot.
Falls a little bit left of target right away. Almost has to give this a shot. And doesn't. Goes for the fill.
So why do you say that at this point, Mike? You don't expect Mark Roth to open or shoot a game under 200?
No, I think Mark Roth's the type of player, and he just seems very aggressive tonight as we see Mike Jasnow's average for the week of 218 and high game of 279 right on this very pair. It just appears Roth is very aggressive, and I don't know, just a type you don't want to get too far behind right away.
Jasnau elects to re-rack on lane 33. There you see the scoreboard. Roth with a big double in the second and the third. Actually, Jasnau should have started with a double. Left a solid nine in the second. If you can rectify that situation on lane 33.
Oh boy, he's in big trouble now. The Greek church, the 4-6-7-9-10. You probably will shoot for the three on the right and hope that he can hit the six pin thin, that it will deflect off the nine and he'll get a kick on the 4-7.
Mike, well, we'll touch on something when we come back here in just a moment. I ask you how you can...
Oh, my goodness. Got four out of the five. How you can throw two great shots and then throw it through the nose a couple of times. But Mark Roth is feeling a little bit better. He leads by 35. We'll be back with more of match number one right after this message.
Time for a Stickley photo tip.
Here's three good ways for improving your photos. Number one, move in closer. Most pictures that I look at would be greatly improved.
Feel may be the greatest of all time, although that's strictly opinion. Mark Roth still very much alive.
And you see that with a below 500 career TV mark.
It's hard to believe. It just shows you how difficult it is to win game after game on television. Roth looking for the turkey on the right-hand lane. Take a commanding 45-pin lead. He likes it, but once again, the solid 10, Mike Durbin.
Keeps Jasnau in the match. Barely breathing, but he has a little life left in him.
Well, it's early, though, Mike. It's only the fourth frame.
But you just don't give a bowler like Roth a 35-pin lead and expect it to... he's not going to lose the match. You're going to have to come back and beat him.
That's a good point. He is a tremendous match play bowler. But he struggled the last couple of years as far as winning is concerned. I asked him what his thoughts were about tonight, maybe winning title number 33.
Well, Denny, I bowled well over the last 2.5 years. I've led some tournaments, had some bad luck on TV, and hopefully today I'll be able to change that luck and go on and win my 33rd title.
Start talking numbers like that 33rd title. I mean, most of us, we can't even count that high. Another solid 10. Three 10-pins out of five frames for Mark Roth. He anticipated leaving some of them with that bowling ball, and he is.
He's no different than any league bowler when you leave those solid 10s. The pros don't know why it happens. All he can do is keep stepping up there and throwing the same shot, right?
Cross lane. At the 10-pin, no problem. Side view of the great Mark Roth, sometimes sixth at one, two, three. Now he pushes it. There's four, five, six. Look at the high backswing. I thought he had lowered it some, but it's still real high. And then the power coming through. And there is the adjustment for the high hit in the third frame. And he leaves the washout, the 110 in the fifth frame. He's lost right now.
Mike, let's go back to that point. Jasnau threw two excellent shots in the first two frames, and now it looks like he's moved to a completely different pair. Why?
Well, bowling's such a mental game, Dan. You get thoughts in your mind, and your opponent getting a double, and you getting a bad break right away. It made him tighten up just a little bit as he goes for the spare and doesn't convert it. It's just so much of a mental game.
Now, I asked him about bowling Mark Roth in his opening match here. You're actually bowling a legend in his own time, and this is what Mike had to say.
Well, the strategy doesn't depend on my opponent. I'm just going to go out there and try to make good shots and bowl a good game and let the score, whatever happens, happens.
Whatever happens, happens. You know, he used to say that all the time? Mark Roth. Just go out, bowl your best, and that's all you can do. Jasnau completely lost on lanes 33 and 34, and that's a shame because, as Mike mentioned earlier, this young gentleman averaged better than 260. On this pair throughout the week.
It's interesting.
Boy, pressure does amazing things to people, doesn't it?
Well, another day does amazing things. You know, he's not the same person he was yesterday. We all change a little bit day to day. And the lanes are a little bit different, obviously. He's just not getting the same reaction, and his confidence is not as high. Yesterday, maybe he wasn't bowling Mark Roth either.
True. Roth leads by 44. Comfortable lead. Or the PBA Hall of Famer.
Roth playing deeper inside than Jasnau is. Jasnau going more or less down the boards around the sixth or seventh board. Roth in around the second arrow, bellying out to around the sixth or seventh board down the lane. And trying to bring it back. And
boy, that's a lot of
money.
Hard cash, isn't it? A lot of people at this point wondering when Mark may surpass the all-time leading money winner, Earl Anthony. Uh-oh. Around the 2-8, picked off the 2 and not the 8, so there is a glimmer of daylight for Mike Jasnau.
Very slight glimmer. Neither bowler exactly tearing him up right here.
Mark trailing, I think, Earl, by around $38,000. If he would win here this evening, $18,000 on top, he would be, what, within $20,000. Wouldn't take him long to get that.
No, but Earl is bowling every now and then. That's he can right. always add to it.
Well, he can, of course, add to his earnings on the seniors tour as well.
Another 10-pin. What's happening here is he has chosen to use a ball, evidently, with a little harder surface, a little higher friction, one that doesn't bite the lane as much, and the ball just not driving through the pins and leaving these corner pins, the 10-pin, left four of them now already in seven frames.
He's had a storied past as far as his hand is concerned. Before the telecast this evening, Mark put it out in front of Mike and I. He's got eight different patches on that hand, preventative patches right at this point, and apparently he's still struggling a little bit.
Delivery of Mark Roth. Seven steps. The backswing not as high that time. And the ball is going to deflect here, Dan. Watch the six pin, second from the right. Just didn't have the power to get that 10 pin out.
The 10 pin stands, but Roth still leads by 31. Don't go away. Jasnau is still not out of the wood.
That's unbelievable. I can remember a friend of mine was a pole vaulter in high school, and when they did 15 feet, that was outstanding.
I guess you could call him a two-story man, huh?
Jasnau needs to find something in a hurry.
And then all of a sudden, it's perfect. Boy, it's amazing what a commercial timeout will do. And there is his brother, Tim, who is offering support at this stage. And I think Tim liked that shot a whole lot better than the last couple.
And we'd never know they were brothers, would we?
slight resemblance. Mike Jasnau trying to right himself a little bit and maybe put a little pressure back on Mark Roth.
He has to strike here. He's still a possible 204, and Roth's going in at a 195 pace right now. So when you can string strikes, it changes things. When you do that, it doesn't change anything.
The ball appears to be hooking a little bit early, Mike. Throughout the week, it didn't seem to do that. But right now, if you set it a little short, it seems to go left almost immediately.
Well, he put that one high, didn't he? I mean, he came up at the line. He jerked through with the follow-through. He wasn't smooth and fluid. No problem with the spare, but he needed a double. Looks good at the start. Good push away. Comes up there. See that quick follow through? Didn't stay with it at all, Ben. I mean, he just was in a hurry trying to aim it and hoping it would wind up in the pocket. It was not well executed at all. Roth, though. Oh! The 10-pin barely falls.
Well, Mark Roth showing a little emotion there. As the 10-pin finally toppled.
Nothing scowl on his face right there at that 10-pin.
Hey, I'd be scowling too if I was throwing it that good, leaving those doggone solid 10-pins. The bowler's nemesis on the right side. Of course, the left-handers have to contend with those solid sevens.
Roth can just about lock it up with a double here. Ooh, the 3-6. Unlike Mark Roth, he has a chance to put his opponent away and did not do it. Right now, Jasnau can strike out for 184 and force Mark Roth to mark in the 10th frame.
Mark with a match play record of 13 wins, 11 losses this week. Jasnau was 13-10-1. It was difficult to win matches this week for the most part.
Parker Bohn didn't have too much trouble.
Nope. You're the top seed, you usually don't, though. So Roth converts. He leads by 31. And Mike Jasnau as his back against the wall.
Has to have it. It doesn't. 3-6-9, and it's going to be history for Mr. Jasnau. It's chalk it up to experience and say, well, fifth this week, and maybe we'll do better next week.
And what do you learn by finishing fifth, Mike Durbin? This is Mike's third appearance on national television. He bowled pretty well the first two times in the King of the Open in Kansas City.
Well, in this particular situation, I think he just chose the wrong bowling ball. He had a maroon one that he was using, and it appeared to me that he was striking better with that. He doesn't even have it out there with him.
Well, he's adding insult to injury at this point. The best he could shoot would be 160, and we all know that Mike Jasnau is a much better bowler than that. One of those experiences where, as Mike said, it's a long, tough night, and all you do is shake it off and head back next week to Southern California and try all over again. Mike's TV record coming in was 2 wins and 2 losses. So he'll dip just below the 500 level. Much more speed on that shot, but that figures right. You leave the 10 pin.
Well, that's relaxed now. The worst thing can happen has already happened.
Yeah. Boy, that's a gut-wrenching feeling when you're out there and all of your friends and relatives are watching on national television. You try the best that you possibly can.
And you bowl 150. I've had it happen to me. So.
What's the lowest game you ever shot on national television, Mike?
I bowled 150. I forget if it was 150. 6 or 7 against David Ozio for the title in Tucson.
Oh, brother.
1985, I think it was.
Bet you slept well that night.
Yeah.
You were sleepwalking during the title match.
Started that match with a double, too.
Oh, man. No. You didn't have to say that, Mike. Oh, well. Tough, tough, tough on a third-year pro, Mike Jasnau. He'll learn from this experience, though. He's a tremendous player. And he strikes on the final shot, Mike. Offering his congratulatory handshake to Mark Roth. 150 the score for Jasnau, and this will be one that he'll try and forget as soon as possible.
Question is whether Roth's going to find the right combination to knock over the 10 pin. Finding the 1-3 pocket has not been a problem. But knocking that 10 pin out like that has been.
Mark standing there with the, well, will it strike this time or not look on his face, and obviously he carried. Could shoot 205 if he throws two more strikes. At this point in time, Mike, do you think that Mark maybe should use another ball in the fill situation since he's already won just to maybe take a couple of shots?
Well, it would be a thought, but I don't think Mark Roth's going to do it. He's going to try and rev it up a little bit more, lift it a little harder, maybe have a little more loft, something like that, to find a way to knock that 10 pin over.
Mark Roth with the spare will shoot 195 and lift his career record on television to 64 victories against 71 defeats. He makes the 2-8. He's 0 for 2 in that department, but he wins nevertheless. 194 to 150, a low-scoring affair, but the scores don't mean much. All you want to do is keep climbing the ladder, and that's what Mark Roth has done here in game number one of the $125,000 Columbia 300 Open. Only one double in that match, in the second and the third.
Well, you have 4 10 pins and 4 strikes.
And there you see the Columbia 300 contingent. Ron Herman, the president of Columbia Industries, on the left, his lovely wife, and then John Jowdy, a special guest on the Bowling News, which is coming up next.
Millions of miles and millions of cars. They're riding on Kendall Motor Oil. That's what I hear.
Every year, more Americans discover the protection that only comes with the unique, pure quality of Kendall Motor Oil.
They're riding on Kendall Motor Oil. Year after year.
Kendall, protection worth its weight in gold for more than 100 years. For every man who wears Brute.
News, and now that the PBA summer tour is nearly one-third over, I thought now might be an opportune time to update you on the Bowler of the Month Awards, which were instituted earlier this year by the Bowling Writers Association of America. So let's get caught up on just what's happening. After bowling the first perfect game on national television in over a decade, Houston's Pete McCordick had to be the pick of the month in January. In February and March, Walter Ray Williams Jr. and Randy Peterson were cited for their consistent efforts. Pete Weber's triumph in the Firestone Tournament of Champions gained him the April honors, while Rick Steele Smith's surprise victory in the ABC Masters topped all of the May performances. Speaking of Rick Steele Smith, he was the number one choice on the just-announced Collegiate Bowling All-America team, chosen by the National Collegiate Coaching Bowling Association. This year's first team represents every section of the United States, further proof of the widespread growth of collegiate bowling. And heading up the women's team is talented Jackie Sellers out of Penn State, the current Collegiate Bowler of the Year. San Jose State is well represented this year by both Kim Terrell and Maja Rode. They both were elevated to the upper echelon.
Meanwhile, the Bluegrass State, which is normally noted for its basketball prowess, well, earlier this year they had a first-team selection. Moorhead State's Sharon Owen grabbed a few headlines of her own. Bringing you up to date on the latest PBA regional action, Bruce Russell held the hot hand out here in the Great Northwest, capturing a PBA regional in front of the hometown fans. Meanwhile, Mark Honea finished atop the stack down south in the latest Southern Region event. And for the past 55 years, the nation's bowling proprietors have convened 1 week a year, and they will be convening and meeting this week in beautiful Hawaii. Among those being honored this year by the BPAA are past president Nick Mormando, former tournament director Syl Sabansky, and journalist Mort Luby Jr. As noted bowling writer John Archibald once said, he has helped so many PBA competitors to success that he has been called a genius in the sport. The man of who I speak is the incomparable cigar-toting Texan himself, John Jowdy. John, pretty lofty praise there from an outstanding bowling writer, but what is the secret to your success?
10% observation and 90% luck.
Okay, now, come on, be honest with me, really. You don't do as well as you have with the pros out here as far as instructing and helping them without knowing what you're doing.
Well, when you have men of this talent, it's rather easy. You just keep an eye on what they're doing, and after 40 or 50 years in this game, you learn to look for certain things that they do wrong, and you try to correct them.
I mean, the bowling fans had a chance to see there Mark Roth, Marshall Holman, some of the players that you have helped through the years. Let's take Mark specifically. He's on the telecast this evening. What have you done in the past to help him become a better player?
Keeping his hand lower. He has a habit sometime of getting his hand too high on the release, and the ball goes offline. If he keeps his hand low and follows through with it low, he's a tough man to beat.
I know you're an advocate of the hand release. That's probably your specialty, wouldn't you say?
Right. That's what I believe is the key to the game today, especially.
Now, what about Marshall Holman? After he won the Firestone Tournament of Champions, he gave you a lot of credit for that victory.
Well, it was just a couple of small things that he was doing wrong. He was sliding away from the shot, and he was coming off the side of the ball instead of under that he's accustomed to, and I showed him how to stay under it, and he accomplished a slide on his own. He's one of the greatest bowlers ever lived.
Let me ask you this, John. Do you go out and offer advice, or do the pros, in essence, come up to you and say, listen, John, I'm having a problem, or is it a little of both?
Well, the easiest way to get yourself hung is to just walk up to somebody and tell them that they're doing something wrong. No, you just, if they ask you, try to notice what they're doing, and then you go from there. You never offer advice. Too many of those.
Well, listen, do me a favor here before you leave Seattle. I've been chicken winging a lot of shots like Mike Durbin used to teach me, but maybe you can straighten me out on that. We'll be back with more of the bowling news right after these messages. Bowling news, Denny Schreiner along with Mike Durbin, $125,000 Columbia 300 open, lots of cash on hand this week. Speaking of money, let's update them on the list.
Well, we're going to take a look at the top 10 money winners. What everyone's out here to make is that dollar. The leading money winner, still Pete Weber at $151,000. Pete McCordick second, he finished 25th this week. Del Ballard third, Randy Peterson fourth, and the great Marshall Holman fifth. Dave Ferraro is at $78,000. Brian Voss, ninth, with $60,000. Nine guys over $60,000. And Amleto Monticelli, right at that $60,000 mark with $59,540. Our leading averages, Marshall Holman again, 218. Pete Weber at 217.8. Ferraro, 215. Ozio, 215. Albee, the first lefty, at 215. Right on down the line, and Brian Voss at 214.1. 10 guys averaging over 214, Denny. Scores are high this summer and winter.
Why do you sound so surprised? You used to average 220, 225 all the time, right? Just kidding, Mike. Now let's talk about the left-handers, a resurgence for the Southpaws. The last couple of weeks, they have really come to the top.
Well, last week we had 9 in the top 24 and 2 in our top 5. This week we got 3 in the top 5. And I think the story this week, Den, is that Parker Bohn III, he seems like a budding superstar, one that can really just blossom if he wins here tonight. Here's our stats for the week. All the bowlers average 203, right-handers 203.5, and the lefties a little bit better at 206. You needed 205 to make the money, 53rd place, and 211 to get into our top 24. Parker Bohn, again, 19-4-1, had the best match play record. Most consecutive 200s, though, by...
23-year-old Lost Coat, winner of five straight stakes races, including the Alabama Derby, the Illinois Derby, and the Ohio Derby. So thoroughbred racing coming up on ESPN. And here we go, match number two. Mark Roth once again starting on the left-hand lane in match number two.
Well, that's Scott Deaver's choice, as he has a higher finishing position, so he gets to choose what lane he wants to finish in on, and all the players except for one chose to finish on the left lane, that one being Bobby Jacks. Roth, who did not throw a practice ball at all in between. He had some interesting strategies. He leaves the 3, 6, 9, 10. Roth didn't throw any practice. He can go over to the adjacent lane and practice in between, but he didn't do that. And it appears that his first shot here was just a little bit soft with the speed, as he didn't get out of that thumb plane. The ball hooks way too soon. He's got a tough spare. Scott Deavers, on the other hand, see the spare, doesn't make it. Gives Deavers an open right away. Deavers on the practice pair over here was not practicing at all. Didn't throw any shots until he gets four shots when he comes over here, and that's all he got, and he's ready to go. So these guys don't believe in too much practice.
5 foot 11 inch, 145 pounds, Scott Deavers, 25 years of age, out of Centerville, Indiana.
Trips at six right away. That's the way Billy Hardwick used to do it on the right side.
Deavers, an interesting player, to say the least. You see 207.04 is 87 average, but he averaged better than 221 in this week's tournament. He was the top pin getter.
He also was the leading bowler in PTQ. He led the PTQ, which is the Pro Tour qualifier that we have before the tournament for players to qualify to get in the tournament for the double. And trips to six again. Well, two trip sixes right away.
He averaged 234 en route to leading that PTQ, Mike Durbin. And so obviously it's been very successful here in Seattle for Scott Deep.
He likes Skyway Park lanes.
Well, here's the master, Mark Ron. He realizes very quickly he better come up with something in a hurry or he's going to be out to lunch. Popcorn shot, but geez, the seven pin didn't go anywhere.
Light hit, blew them all out of there, but the five pin and the hit pin, neither one got to the seven pin.
Isn't it supposed to be the veteran that comes out and throws the key double and the youngster supposed to be making the mistakes?
Right, these youngsters, they're so nervous. He's bowling Mark Roth. He's scared to death, isn't he?
Boy, oh boy. And people don't realize just how tough it is to win out here. You got a great player like Mark Roth, and he's going to have to pull out all the stops to beat this youngster from Indiana.
Well, it's early. It's early in the match, yeah.
Mark Roth, four times PBA Player of the Year, five times won the George Young Memorial High Average Award. 1978, I had the pleasure of working on the tour and watched him win eight tournaments, Mike Durbin, maybe the greatest year in the history of any bowler.
I remember that.
Oh, brother.
I was out here bowling regularly, as you know. That
probably
time.
Beat you a few times in the process. What a great year. Gave it plenty of room, and this one came charging back. So on the left-hand lane, Roth comes up with a big strike, and he needed it.
Well, you need one before you can start a string. Profound statement there.
Deavers on a double, leading by 21. I think it's imperative that he stay ahead throughout the entire match.
I agree. Very unusual swing. Gave it too much room. And that's nerves. I really believe that that's simply nerves. He came up and was just a little bit high the first two shots, and he thought, well, I don't want to go high and leave a split and give him an opening, and he just threw it out the window.
And there you see the high game, 277. What a tremendous average, 221.68. And I mentioned he was the top pin getter.
And he better not miss the spare. Doesn't want to give Roth any openings right away.
Perfect. Beautiful conversion. And he shakes his head a little bit and breathes a sigh of relief.
Watch his swing. Very unusual. Comes back, bounces out away, and then back in. From now on, though, he's right in there. He goes right through it at the target.
It's almost like the old figure eight swing, isn't it?
Almost.
Made famous by Billy Whalen? Or no?
Well, Whalen, was he just did it with his hand. He didn't do it with his swing. Leaves a six this time. Ball rumbled just a little bit, nicked that thumb hole right at the end. Again, indicating a little bit of nerves.
This is Scott's first appearance in the championship round this year and the second of his career. Last fall in the True Value Open in Indianapolis, Scott finished fifth, losing the opening match to John Gant, 242 to 203.
He's 6 out of 14, not outstanding, but if he could win this one, it would sure help the bank account. Well, it's enough to pay the bills and get some experience on the PBA Tour. He leads by 16 pins, but the crafty veteran, Mark Roth, getting ready to get lined up. Stay tuned. The range where you try and line up, Mike, give us an idea where the players are lined up this week.
Well, we're going to take a look at what Mark Roth is playing. He's playing around this second arrow, sending the ball out and trying to bring it back in this fashion. And Scott Devers is going less more toward the first arrow, down the boards and having it come in this way. Then we're going to get an idea of what it looks like at the object here at the pins. Roth trying to have it finish right in here, solid, a little more curved than I drew there. And Devers coming in from the outside into the 1-2 pocket. Roth into the 1-3. Both of them want to get that 10 pins in the pit.
Boy, I'll bet you were great at Etch-a-Sketch when you were a kid. They used to have those when you were a kid. That's back when they had. That was even before the hula hoop, I think. Oh, well, never mind.
No, I never could do the hula hoop.
There you go.
I got trouble with that.
Roth looking for a key double in the fourth. Cut the lead to 6. Solid. You don't see Mark Roth get down on one knee very often, Mike, but I think he is already sized up the match and realized he needs to take control.
Well, he wants to put some pressure on this young player. Like he's saying, I'm the veteran here. I'm supposed to come out with the strikes. I'm not supposed to open right away and let this kid get a double on me. He can take the lead right here with one more. Take the lead. Tie. Baby split, 3-10. Just a little lax on that speed again there. Just needs to give that ball room on both lanes. Watch him. 6 to 7 steps. Ball grabs too soon. No chance right here. Roth, a great spare and split shooter. Does not hook the ball at it and makes it. If he'd have thrown the hook at it, see, he would have missed it.
Mark said that after his first full year on tour, that he could strike with anybody out there. The only problem was making spares. He went home and learned how to shoot spares. He said, Denny, he said, basically what I did was I really straightened things out, straightened the hook out, and just try and throw it hard right at the pins. And he said, ever since then, I think I've been a pretty fair spare shooter.
Oh, it's been an outstanding spare shooter.
Probably the best on the tour. Devers trying to answer the call. Oh, slaps that 6-pin silly on the right side. He's got that shot down.
Well, he's done it 3 out of 4 times. But he's hitting that same hit.
That drives you crazy, too, when you're on the bench and you're watching. You realize he's throwing a pretty good shot, but boy, you start tripping those 4s and 6s, and you get nightmares watching those.
The old demoralizer shot, Ben.
It'll psych you out worse than anything else in the world.
Right now, up by 8 can make it 18 and really put some heat on the veteran. Trying to trip it again. He figures, well, if it worked before, it'll work again, but it didn't.
Boy, it's amazing when you look at Mark Roth, how high his backswing is, and then you look at Scott Devers, and it barely gets it to his waist. There's just so many ways to be competitive in this game.
But what is interesting is a player like Devers with that short backswing, you expect him to be accurate because he doesn't have that big trajectory. But Roth is just as accurate even with a much higher backswing.
And obviously with much more power, too, a lot more area. Mark Roth last year winning $84,000, and at this point at $39,000. There you see the co-proprietors here at Skyway Park Bowl. And of course, Ron, I think that Dave Pardee and his brother Rod, and the rest of the family, the Pardee contingent, all the kids on hand here. Roth with a dice-o-matic strike on the right-hand lane. And both players beginning to zero in just a little bit.
Well, the momentum, as Roth asked for a re-rack, I think still rests with Roth right now. He just has an era about him that he just feels like he's going to win. It's just a matter of when he's going to do it in the match. He's going to take command. But he hasn't yet. He still trails by 8.
And he re-racks on lane 33. The pride of Spring Lake Heights, New Jersey, decided he didn't like the rack. Trying for his second double of the match. Lead by 2 if he strikes here.
Again, and this time it's more difficult. The 3-9-10. This is one of my tips later on. He can't throw the ball straight at this particular split. He's going to have to hook it at this. And he's just getting an early reaction. This lane is supposed to be tighter, and it's fooling him right now. I think he even moved deeper, and it hooked quicker.
And he is really throwing the ball hard, too, Mike. Plenty of acceleration.
He's going to have to hook the ball at this spare. He can't make it throwing straight. Through the hook. And that's when you shoot it from the left like that, that's the result.
So an open for Roth in the seventh frame could turn out to be pivotal. He leads, or I should say he trails right now by 15. There you see the leader. And let me correct myself. It's a 20-pin lead for Scott Devers, who is up and ready to shoot here in the seventh frame.
And he's been standing in that exact position now for the last 30 seconds, just with his head down and concentrating on what he wants to do.
Career earnings of $43,609. I would love to add $18,000 the first place check to that total.
And it took a little extra time.
Boy, that's the result. Well, that was his best shot of the match right there. Just nice and smooth and clean. Scott cashed in his very first regional tournament. Of course, cashed in his first national tournament.
As we mentioned at the top of the show, as we see that graphic there, that hasn't happened since the Peoria tournament in 1986, tournament that a right-hander won.
What's going through Mark Roth's mind at this stage?
How to hit that left lane.
For the double. Perfect. Boy, he's zeroed in. Well, that was Pac City on the left-hand lane, so Devers with a crunching double in the seventh and the eighth has now developed a 30-pin lead.
Devers playing out around that first arrow. Again, makes a perfect shot here. Ball not getting nearly the revs that Ross ball does, as we see Ross ball right now.
But the same result. Right now, Roth is potential 215 if he strikes out.
He has not struck on the left lane since the third frame. He needs to find this left lane right now because he's been hitting the right lane. Scott Devers is going at a 215 pace right now. The difference is 30 pins, but it's still anybody's match.
Roth needs to make an adjustment. Mike will talk about making adjustments on the approach in his tip coming up in just a couple of moments. Boy, he gave that one plenty of room. How about it? Come on back, and there's a slashing strike. And so the seasoned veteran keeps his hopes alive.
He moved a little bit more, and he increased the speed and threw it further right.
Well, the great ones make the great adjustments, don't they?
The ball gets out around the fifth board down there and comes in light and carries that high percentage light hit. Devers leading by 20, needs to get one more. And does, perfect. Right now he just needs a mark. That does it, if he can just mark in the 10th frame. As Roth says, what am I going to do when he throws him like that?
I think Mark at this point appreciating Scott Devers' ability. It doesn't get any easier. Mark will be the first one to tell you that there are nothing but great young prospects out here on the PBA tours. He's still kind of smiling and looking over at the monitor. I think Mark realizes he's just been beat by the better bowler, perhaps.
Why is that not beat yet? He needs a mark.
Oh, that's true.
And oh, my goodness. He did not get it. He left the 4-6-10, and he's going to open in the 10th frame. Mark Roth will need two strikes to win. He'll finish with 201, 210. Roth will need two strikes in the 10th frame.
You see Mark's calculator shifting into high gear as he looked up at the scoreboard, realizing exactly what he needed. And the right-hand lane has been the better of the two lanes for him.
That's right.
Burning question now is, will be... can he carry the 10-pin? Because he's definitely hit the pocket virtually every shot on the right-hand lane 34.
And Devers is just kicking himself. He had the match won, just needed the mark. Count was unimportant.
Well, Mark Roth has talked about getting a good break on television. He hasn't had any in quite a while. He might have just gotten one right there if he can take advantage of it.
Yeah, he got it. I'll tell you what. He smells that victory. He really does. He knows that he's got a chance now of moving right up that ladder.
So many times you watch the top pros in any sport, give them an opportunity, and they usually take advantage of it.
Sure does. He asked for a re-rack here on lane 34. He didn't like the rack. He's just thinking about getting that 10-pin out because he's positive he's going to hit the pocket.
Earlier in match play competition, Scott Devers defeated Mark Roth. Roth tries to gain a little revenge here.
That's as much time as I've ever seen Mark Roth take.
And doesn't carry, and Scott Devers is going to move up the ladder. And there you see Scott Devers realizing all of a sudden that he got away with one. And you see the disgust and dismay on Mark Roth's face. Threw an outstanding shot, gave it plenty of room. Just couldn't quite tickle the seven. So Roth will bow out in fourth place, win $5,500 as Scott Devers, just a youngster from Centerville, Indiana, wins 210 to 204. And he'll probably never forget the time he beat Mark Roth on television.
Especially if he can go on and win two more games.
I've just gone through the heart of the pins and left the 4-6-7. A near impossible split, and I'm most likely going to get an open frame. But that's not the real important issue. The important issue is, what kind of adjustment do I now make so that I don't make the same mistake the next time I get up on this lane, and so that I can make the proper adjustment to get a strike? Well, before we get into that specific move, there's a couple things you need to know about moves in general first. First, when I miss left, the move is to move left on the approach. And when I miss right, the move is to move right on the approach. Those are the general moves. Now the specific moves are that when I line myself up and use the inside edge of my left foot here, and if I move one board left on the approach here, it's worth a board and a half at the pins. Go through that again. One board left here on the approach is worth a board and a half at the pins. So two boards here on the approach is worth three at the pins. Now the 1-3 pocket for a right-hander and the 1-2 pocket for a left-hander both sit on the 17th board. In our example, I left the 4-6-7. That went through the heart of the pins or the 20th board. Three boards to the left of where I want to be. So the question is, what kind of move do I now make to get that ball back three boards to the right? Well, remember, one board to the left here was worth a board and a half down there. So two boards to the left here should bring the ball up three boards to the right at the pins and put it right into the 1-3 pocket. Let's try it and see if it works. I set myself up, and when I left that split, on the inside edge of my left foot was on board 22. So I moved two boards to the left, or over board 24, and my target was the second arrow. And I'm going to keep my target the same and not move it. And we'll see if it works. And there you have it. That was the proper adjustment. Remember, one board to the left on the approach back there is worth a board and a half at the pins, and the adjustment for going through the heart of the pins is two boards to the left and keep your strike target. We'll see you again next week.
From Riverside, California, the defending champion, Mats Carlson of Sweden, should be an outstanding field, and we'll be looking forward to the finals next week. Let's get back to the action here tonight, though. Semi-final match, and interestingly enough, an unusual style for Bobby Jacks.
Notice how he has his right hand underneath his left wrist. He does that to keep the wrist in the position that he wants, and then watch at the end of his approach as he gets to the last step, no slide. He's bowled that way throughout his entire career. It's not necessarily something that I recommend, but Bobby Jacks makes it work for him.
Bobby Jacks and Scott Devers and Parker Bohn III from the top seed spot. So three left-handed players. They finished 1, 2, and 3, and we will have a new entrant into the Firestone Tournament of Champions, regardless of who wins here this evening.
It's a big, big for both of these players. Bobby Jacks been out here grinding out a living and hangs, and that ball doesn't get out clean at all. Leaves the 1-3-6. He's been grinding out a living for a number of years now, and this victory could get him into the Firestone Tournament of Champions. Mean a lot to his career at age 40.
From Hayward, California, his career earnings, $174,506. 23 years he's been a member. So he bowled off and on for the better part of two decades.
Started before I did.
That's hard to believe.
At the spare.
It has it. And he's still bowling, Mike.
And just never got his thumb out of this ball. He has no slide to begin with. Look at that look on his face. And then the thumb hangs.
when he hits light. He doesn't want to get a lot of real action there.
Well, he doesn't throw the kind of shot that generates a lot of area, though, does he, Mike? He's a very accurate player that needs to fit the ball in the pocket to throw strikes.
Well, he has that short backswing. We remarked that that leads to accuracy.
And we apologize for some audio problems that we have been having from Seattle here this evening. And you see Bobby Jacks, Scott Devers.
And of all the players on the telecast tonight, Bobby Jacks has chosen to finish on lane 34 on the right lane. Everybody else wanted to finish on the left lane. Here's Scott's earnings for 1987, just 11,000 or 43,000 career. Boy, 18,000 more in a trip to Firestone would pump new life into that, wouldn't it?
Regardless of where he finishes at this point, he'll pick up his biggest PBA paycheck ever as he flushes the pocket on lane 33. He would win $7,000 if he would even lose this match. So obviously he's not thinking about that, though. After you beat Mark Roth, you should be oozing with confidence. Then you take a look at the numbers for Bobby Jacks, age 40. Well, the nerve's still pretty good for 40 years of age.
Hey, what do you think? That's old or something?
Heck no.
A lot of speed, light, and what a break! Rumbles the 3-5-6.
Well, where's the whistle for the cave-in? There you see his wife, and she's saying, come on, Bobby, make it a little easier than that, would you please?
Last night, the left-handers, as we see this week's average of 221 in his high game. Here's this unusual strike. Bobby, five-step player with no slide over about the sixth or seventh board. He barely hits the head pin. The head pin does not hit the three pin. Goes to the wall, comes back, hits both the five and the six falls into the three. As I was about to say, though, the left-handed players last night were inspecting the racks down here, and they all agreed that they didn't necessarily like the rack on lane 33. Thought the two pin was a little in to leading to seven pins on lane 33.
We should point out that the players do get a chance to look at the racks, and then the PBA staff makes the adjustment.
Kind of bounced that one and leaves the seven pin, just what he was thinking of.
So that in essence, Mike, when they do come out for the telecast, the pins are as on spot as they can humanly possibly be, in essence, right?
Every effort is made to get them on spot.
Sure.
In the match play, Denny, Scott Devers defeated Bobby Jacks 247 to 221. So Devers evidently
exactly enjoyed.
Does it? Four steps. Oh, solid seven. Boy, he threw that one well. Shakes his head.
And apparently we are still having some audio problems. We apologize for those, but what the heck? It's 3,000 miles from Seattle to Bristol, Connecticut, so we've lost a couple of words between here and there. But we're making every effort possible. Straighten things out as Scott Devers spares in the fourth, and he leads by nine pins. Plenty of action left here in the semifinal match of the $125,000 Columbia 300 Open. Historic overview of the PBA Tour tournaments in Seattle. Last year, the defending champion in a tremendous show. What an emotional show. Dale Eagle won. Of course, I want to mention these championships were played at Leilani Lanes in Seattle.
In 1985, in a telecast that I was on for a brief appearance of one game, Dennis Jakes was the winner.
And in 84, Don Ginello had the hot hand. 83, Charlie Tappan, a good friend of yours, won in 1982.
And Tommy Hudson, I believe he beat Bob Hanley that year and got a strike in the 10th frame to do it.
Yeah, that's the way to win a championship. And there you see Bobby Jacks, 40-year-old Bobby Jacks of Hayward, California. He trails by nine, shooting in the fourth frame on lane 34 here at Skyway Park Bowl in Seattle, Washington.
And Jack says, if you're going to blow my lights, so will I.
An eye for an eye, and Bobby Jacks 14-8-2 in match play competition this week.
And Scott Devers not even looking at his opponent, head down, concentrating on what he wants to do, and kind of peeks up now. He looks at the rack and tries to see if pins are on spot on lane 34.
It's amazing, those guys, they keep looking down, and they always sneak that quick peek once in a while just to find out what's happening.
Jacks to take the lead for the first time in the match, if he can double. Right through the heart, leaves the 4-7. Good break. He's fighting his release as his wife looks on. He's just not making clean shots.
And there you see 43rd in 1984. Obviously, he has bettered that mark this evening. The winner of this match will bowl Parker Bohn III for the title.
And we were talking with John Jowdy earlier about the hand release being so important right now. That's the part that Jacks is searching to find.
Bounce that one, too.
But it's clean at the spare. See, the pressure is different at the spare. And he got out of that thumb clean and lifted with the fingers at that particular shot, and he's not doing that on the first shot when he has a strikeout.
Scott Devers, among his hobbies, golf and video games. His goal is to win a title and be consistent.
Devers, on the other hand, is throwing almost every shot clean. Just like that.
I think the interesting thing about his game, Mike, is watch what happens to his hand when he's done with the swing. It ends up behind his head. His left hand.
I hadn't noticed that, but I'll watch it on this next shot.
Watch it. This is pretty interesting. I mean, it really accentuates the follow-through. Get the ball down the lane and get it online.
Puts that ball over to the left, where it should be. Then just kind of walks away from it. That's the result. It is interesting how his hand comes in almost like he's going to comb his hair back.
Either that or pat himself on the back for such a great double.
Watch his follow through here. Puts that ball out, controls it, bounces it out. Now brings it back straight from here. He's like anybody else. And the hand comes up and back. And he's going to scratch his back there.
Almost reminiscent of Walter Ray Williams Jr.
Yes. Only Walter does it with his left hand.
That's right. Boy. Interesting analogy.
19 pins, and Jacks better turn on the engine. Another 7 pin.
Much cleaner release, though.
Yeah, but he's running out of frames. This kid just keeps throwing every ball in the pocket. It's intimidating to you when your opponent, you know your opponent's lined up and you can't strike. There's no way to win the match that way, because you don't figure he's going to make a mistake, and if you can't get anything going.
The only thing you can do is pull out the plug, right? Maybe shut the lights down. Figure out you can sneak out, huh?
Cross lane at the 7th pin.
And this is Bobby's first appearance in the championship round this year. Last year, he finished second in the Miller Lite Challenge. He was the top seed, but he lost to Dave Husted, 225 to 210 in Tucson, Arizona. Golden Pin Lanes will be down there in, a couple of weeks?
He's looking forward to getting there, I'm sure.
I'm sure Pete Tonis, general manager, is readying things at Golden Pin Lanes. Jack's down by 20, could cut the lead in half. Or at least start to, if he strikes here.
He's still potential 239 if he would strike out, so he just needs to get something going. See if Deaver sneaks a peek. Nope, he can hear from the... Now he sneaks the peek.
He looked up.
You can hear
seven.
Those seven pins, can't you?
Well, you can tell from the reaction of the crowd. He heard the crowd go, oh, and he thought, well, is it a split? No, no, it's only a seven pins.
Well, there's a difference between the O's for the soft sevens and the O for the splits.
Right? Yeah, I guess you're right.
Harry Golden, the national tournament director, always warms up the crowd before each telecast. And he says, hey, feel for those guys when they're out there bowling. React to those shots. And normally the crowd will let you know what's happening.
And Bobby Jacks. The cross alley spare trails by 21, and he's still trying to figure out the solution to strikes on lane 33 and 34.
Finals of the $125,000 Columbia 300 Open, live from Skyway Park Bowl in the Emerald City, Seattle, Washington.
And let's see if Scott Devers has got some of that killer instinct anywhere. He can just step on Bobby Jacks with a couple more strikes here. Leads by 21, can increase it to 31 with one more.
Mike, let me ask you a question. Both players are hitting the pocket. Devers is striking. Bobby Jacks is leaving the soft sevens. Why?
Well, in my opinion, the reason is because Jacks has to belly the ball a little bit, has to send it away from the pocket. He hooks the ball slightly more than Devers, and it's just not making it back with enough power to knock out that seven. On the other hand, Devers is going more direct in his angle to the pocket, and the ball's just rolling up there flush right in the 1-2 pocket. Really squashing.
And he does. Boy, up by 41. That's a mark of a very good player inside. What is inside of his heart, because, you know, the tendency then is to play a little safe, and he didn't. He just went step on it. Got him down, keep him there.
Wow. Well, Jacks right now down by a bundle, 41 pins.
Puts enormous pressure on your opponent like that. He knows he's got to strike out to have a prayer.
A little more direct with that shot, if you notice.
Kind of a wry smile on his face there.
I was just going to say that. He certainly realizing he's got his work cut out. But what about that, Mike? A little lick of the tongue on the towel, and he likes to keep that that sliding shoe a little bit cleaned off there because he plants, doesn't he?
Yeah, as long as it doesn't affect the other player, there's no problem with it. Has to have this one. I mean, he wants any chance to win this match. He must strike here.
Tammy, his wife, looking on. Probably hoping and praying for a strike out of her husband. Oh, he shakes him loose. And she obviously enjoys that shot. She's eyeing the scoreboard as well. And, a glimmer of hope.
A little more angle of attack this time. It just appeared that he was a little further outside, and he didn't get the ball up as high as it had been. Comes in light into the pocket and blows him out. I don't think he actually made a move on the approach. He just went a little more direct. Devers to lock it up. And leaves a seven. If he makes this, Dan, he's going to be in the same situation he was in the last match, that he'll need a mark in the 10th frame to lock it up. And don't think he's not thinking about that. He wanted that one. That would have iced it.
He split against Mark Roth in the 10th frame. He could have closed the door on Mark and gave Mark an opportunity to come back and win. Roth got the first one and left the seven pin on the second shot.
He must make the spare, though. No problem. Dead center.
Scott kind of stayed right at the line and watched that one go all the way down the lane till it picked off the seven pin.
He looks up at the scoreboard, reaches for the rosin bag. He knows what he needs to do. He's watching that spare all the way. A little sigh of relief. But he's going to sigh a little bit more if he can put 10 in the pit right here.
Bobby Jack squirming a little bit. He's uncomfortable because he realizes if Devers strikes here, it's good night, Irene.
And it was almost good night, Irene again. He got soft with the speed and right through the heart of the pins, left the 4-7. Good break, broke up the split, needs to make the spare to lock it up.
Possible 236 if he would spare and strike, and that's twice he's been tested. Twice he had an opportunity to shut the door, and in either time he was able to.
It's experience. Okay. That's exactly what it is. Lack of it.
He's kind of learning on the job.
Right.
speed at the spare. That shows what he knew what he needed to do. Now he just needs three pins. Think he can handle it then? Three pins?
Me?
Yes.
That'd be like an even money bet. I'd move left and stay about 6 feet behind the line. Throw it hard and straight, right?
Well, he does need to stay behind that foul line. He does. He's going to move on to bowl for his first title. 235. Well, he continues to bowl very well. Fans applauding the efforts of Scott Devers, so it'll be a pair of young Lions, young left-handed Lions, Parker Bohn III and Scott Devers, and they'll challenge each other for the title.
And the two of them together, their ages added together, barely more than mine. Doesn't matter, he leaves the 6'10", and another chance for Bobby Jacks goes down the drain.
But at the same time, he continues to bowl well. And it's like anything else. You could say that about Mark Roth, how many times he's made the show in the last couple of years and just hasn't been able to win. And then it's so funny, as we were talking about in the car today, Mike, you said you didn't win a match for like 5-6 years on the tour, and then all of a sudden you won 17 or 18 out of 19.
It can turn around. Yeah, it can turn around at any time.
It's almost more mental than anything else.
Yeah, and the position that Scott Devers is in right now, when I got into that position, I was convinced I was going to win. When I'd won one or two matches on television, had a role going like that, I just didn't think, I just figured that everything was going my way that day, and I was going to win.
So Bobby Jacks will have to settle for third place money, which is $7,000. So he crosses over, but it's all academic at this point. He finishes third. 235-205. Another victory for the 25-year-old left-hander from Centerville, Indiana, Scott Devers. And Scott, I think right now, feeling pretty good about his chances. However, he's going to run into a buzzsaw in just a couple of minutes in an outstanding young left-hander from New Jersey. And, of course, Parker Bohn III. There you see the scoreboard, a 30-pin victory. And that victory puts him in the title match. Couple of very talented.
Vegas just missed, and Rick Jones actually had a chance to make the show if he could have struck out in the 10th frame, finished 7th for 3,600. Mark Baker, last week's champion, Palmer Fahlgren, fell from 5th to 9th in that last game, and a new player, Dave Arnold, was 10th.
And on down the list, one of the hotter players on the tour, Dave Ferraro, finishing 11th, the defending champion, Dale Eagle, at 13th, Walter Ray Williams Jr., number 14, and Chris Goddard at 15th.
In 16th, the Vegas Open champion this year, Kent Wagner, Mats Carlsen. Next week's champ, Norm Duke, in the finals again. And Joe Furpo won in Las Vegas. Good-looking young player, Mark McDowell, 20th.
And there you see the final four, Mike Edwards, Randy Lightfoot, Hugh Miller, and Jim Brockbank out of Medford, Oregon. Getting ready now for the title match here in the $125,000 Columbia 300 Open. Mike, what's the deal here? These two guys act as if this is a walk in the park.
I just find it amazing. In my 20 years of experience on the PBA Tour, when I was going to bowl a title match against somebody, I never talked to him. I never said boo to him at that particular time. It's nothing against any one individual, but that was the guy I wanted to beat, and I wanted to beat him. I wanted to win that title, so I didn't talk to him before that match.
Yeah, we'll see if they're friends when this is all over tonight. It is kind of interesting. There you see upcoming on ESPN, the United States Golf Association Senior Championship. First and second round coverage live Thursday, July 9th, 4 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. Friday, July 10th. At 4 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time, Dale Douglas is the defending champion, and my oh my, didn't he play well in the U.S. Open last week at the Olympic Club in San Francisco.
A lot of outstanding play in that particular tournament.
And let's take a look now at the top seed. That's 23-year-old Parker Bohn III out of Freehold, New Jersey, Mike Durbin. I've talked to a number of professionals out on the tour this week, and they all say this kid's got the label. He is a tremendous player. It's just a question of when he's going to break out of the mold and start to win.
Four-step player with a very nice free swing. We're going to take a look at it right now. It's seen from behind and the side. Pushes the ball and steps at the same time. It's into the swing and free right now. Look at the, comes back and nice and straight. A little open shoulder. Look at him fill that hole with a nice long side. Now watch the follow through. Straight up, I'll tell you what, he's a pretty good looking young player. He's accurate, he makes his spares, and he's not afraid.
And for the first time ever in his career, he will bowl out of the top spot, and he'll bowl for his first PBA title in a trip to the Firestone Tournament of Champions. Whoever wins this match, they'll be scheduling some travel
to head to Akron this coming April.
And already we see that he's probably at a disadvantage as the top seed has won only 7 of 20 tournaments this year. He's making Devers finish on the right lane.
Scott Devers with victories over Mark Roth and Bobby Jacks would like to make it 3 in a row and capture the championship. Long way to go at this stage.
And, oops, did anybody get wet on that particular shot? I used to say that when my ball would do that and leave that solid 5.
Amazing. Earlier this week in match play, Mats Carlson here left the sour apple.
And Matt's the same.
5, 7, and 10.
Yeah, that's the same. Thanks, Denny, for telling everybody that.
But Matt's picked up the 5-7. And he looked at me and he said, Denny, if I had one more shot, I could make the spare.
At the spare, should be no problem for the 5-pin.
Boy, the crowd seems to really be into this title match. You can feel the electricity. 23 years of age. 5'10", 144 pounds, a slender left-hander with plenty of power. Oh, my! First shot right out of the gate, and that's about as flush as you can get, Mike Durbin.
And the emotion showing on Parker Bohn as he runs even the first shot out.
And a little extra added incentive here, sitting with us in the booth. 32-time PBA champion Mark Roth is going to join us for the title game, give us his observations of that championship pair, even though he shoots from the right side and these two young lefties are playing from the other angle.
On the crossover, a lot of speed. He's really throwing with a lot of speed today.
Mark, let me ask you a question real quick. I know that you bowl out of the Eastern Region, so does Parker Bohn III. Your thoughts about his play?
Parker's a very good young bowler. He's learned a lot over the last 3-4 years, and he was telling me today lane 33 was hooking more than 34, and for the right side, it was complete opposite, which is normal for us.
So he spares up in the second, and I guess you got to feel a little more comfortable, Mike Durbin. You get through the first couple of shots, now you ease up a little bit and relax, but he's facing a player that's really hot at this point.
Well, Scott was given second life by Mark not striking out in the 10th frame on a shot that looked like a pretty high percentage hit for Mark. Averaging 222 for his first two games.
Just like that. He says, well, I left the 5-pin first time, but this time I'll put some fingers in it.
Took care of things in the second frame. And Mark, it's kind of amazing when you figure how many years you've been out here, and then you look out at a couple of youngsters, and you have to remember back in 1972 when you made your first telecast.
Yes, I do, Danny. I was very nervous the first night, and getting on the show and bowled Don Johnson, and he was bowler of the year the previous year, and it was nerve-wracking.
Ooh, leaves the 6-pin.
It's funny how your first anything ever in life you always remember probably more graphically than anything else, perhaps your last performance too, but that first one always sticks in your mind, and of course you lost that match, didn't you?
Lost by 23 pins.
Yeah, but you've won a few since then.
A couple.
Oh, geez, a couple. Devers trying to convert the cross alley spare. And he does. Mark, we mentioned before this title match, Parker Bohn III and Scott Devers chatted with each other and exchanged pleasantries before the match. And Mike Durbin said, geez, I never talked to the guy I was bowling for a title match. What about you?
Not really. Today I was in good mood, but Parker's loose and he has a lot of confidence. That's the reason why he's talking.
Trips the 6-pin out of there. Good break. Same hit that Devers had in the third frame, only he got it out. There's his mother rooting him on.
And she traveled most of the first year that he played out here, and she just loves to watch her son bowl. And, I mean, heck, if I was his mom, I think I'd watch him play, too, as good as he is.
Interesting that Mark here said that the left lane is hooking more for the left-hander, yet Parker chose to finish on that particular lane.
He told me there's no question in his mind that the ball is hooking earlier than it has all week long.
There we see the score, all even. Bowler's just striking in alternate frames. High. 2-4-8. Tough spare.
And there you see him shake his head a little bit, and the one-pin spares are tough enough. Three-pin spares are a real adventure.
It looks like what he's trying to do is make the adjustment on that left lane with speed. And make sure that he keeps the speed, but he's going to have to make a move or something, a couple of a board or two with his feet to get that ball into the 1-2 pocket. At the spare. And not the way he planned it, but he got it done.
Yeah, but it all looks the same on the scoreboard, and we're even Steven at this point in the early stages of the title match. Stay tuned. This one should be a dandy. And the winner of the title match will receive a nice check for $18,000 this evening.
Second place, not too bad at $9,500. Bobby Jacks took home $7,000, and Mark Roth sitting right beside us at least made $5,500. $4,500 went to fifth place tonight.
That's right. So Mark is buying this evening because he won $5,500. Next week on the PBA Summer Tour, the Southern California Open, live and direct from Riverside, California, Wednesday, July 1st, 9 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. But let's move back to the present, as they say, and back to frame number four in the title match. We're all even Steven here.
And both players are picking on lane 34. Bohn has two strikes on it. Devers looking for his second.
And gets it. Looked like he was almost a little soft with that shot, but the ball held pocket.
Mark, through the years, what was the key for you to come back out of the commercial break and make a good, firm shot?
Keep my speed up. My tendency of coming out of commercial is slow down, and I want to keep the same tempo we've had from the beginning of the game.
It appears that the first player that gets the first double in this match is going to have a tremendous psychological and physical advantage.
So Devers will try and take full advantage of that here in the fifth. Light. Oh, it came up high. Trips that six. That lane is hooking. Well, it's amazing what will happen to your confidence if you start tripping those six pins and four pins.
Yes, sir. I can remember a few.
A few? Mike, you were king of tripping the fours for years. Admit it.
Bohn is just wired. Interesting. He picked the finish on the other lane.
Was that a mistake on his part, Mark, do you think?
I think he wanted to finish first and put the pressure on Scott, but it looks like right now it's not working to his liking.
Unless he makes an adjustment here on lane 33, he has struggled on the left-hand lane. Wonder if he had a chance to watch Mike Durbin's tip.
They made the adjustment. I don't know whether he moved or whether he kept it, just tried to do it with speed or what he did, but whatever it did, it wound up in that solid, that 1-2 pocket. Boy, this is a big shot for him, and he just threw it beautifully. Look at how clean the release is. Heavy fingers, and that ball's rolling like crazy. Tremendous shot, and he knows it.
That Houdini shot, the disappearing act. Back to live action. Scott Devers trying to answer the call, and doesn't quite trip the six. Had it wiggling just a little bit, tantalizing six pin.
Just an eyelash high.
I know you thought you were going to say freckle, didn't you? That's why you said eyelash. That's fine.
At the six pin, no trouble. And we should comment that during the commercial break at 3.5 frames, these two guys were chatting with one another again. So,
Mark, what are your thoughts about that?
No, I wouldn't do that. I might give my opponent a dirty look, but never talk to him.
You aren't going to exchange pleasantries. Maybe not until after you're done.
And we see now that Devers is trailing by one.
Yeah.
Seventh frame.
Yeah, but these are contemporary players. This is a different era.
I guess it must be.
Sure it is.
Boy, he's just thrown every ball in the pocket.
Well, he sets up an opportunity for a double, but meanwhile, back at the ranch here in the seventh frame on the right-hand lane, Parker Bohn the third could take an 11-pin lead with a strike here.
Seems to be the crowd favorite. Bohn seems to be the crowd favorite here. A little extra time.
Sister looking on, and she likes that way that seventh pin snapped right out of there. Well, he certainly knows how to strike. During one PBA regional, he shot back-to-back 300 games. You don't have to be a genius to realize that's 24 straight strikes.
Well, right now he's got three in a row, looking for just four, and if he gets that, it's going to put him up 21 pins.
Trying to win that first ever PBA title. Two fine, talented young left-handers really providing a show.
He's got it.
Well, Parker Bohn III took off
for the races. As soon as he let that shot go, the confidence building, and he knew right away, as soon as he let the ball go, it was a strike.
The free swing under pressure. And you can't throw it under any better, I mean, even in practice, than that under pressure.
Yeah. They may be friends before the match, but he was right back in his face when that struck.
Has to strike here. Soft seven, the six, and then the adjustment. A little more speed and leaves the soft seven, and he's in trouble. 21 down. The best he can get now, if he picks this up and strikes out, is 229. Bohn with four in a row, going at virtually a 229 pace right now. He hasn't lost count yet, so it's still somewhat in doubt. But as they say, Bohn is in the catbird seat.
Uh-oh.
Now it's almost all over right now.
Mental error,
missing that seven pin, reduces his possibilities to 217. Cross lane at the seven pin, wants to get it over about the middle arrow, and he just had too much angle. The ball doesn't bite and come back.
Scott said the key to his success this week was his consistency, and he's been working very hard on making his spares. Obviously, a lapse in concentration there has cost him dearly. Tries to bounce back. Oh, how about him? A little slap shot there from behind. A little clipping may have been called on lane 33. Where was the yellow flag, Mike Durbin?
Well, he's still alive as he's potential 217. If Parker Bohn would open one of these last two frames, however, Parker strikes here, the match is going to be history.
Boy, if you've watched Parker Bohn, the third bowl here tonight, and say, geez, he looks like a player, a PBA Hall of Famer, used to bowl out on the tour, Dave Davis. Well, it's because Parker Bohn has worked quite often with Dave Davis and credits Dave with much of his success.
Leaves the six pin. Making this, he's going to have to mark in the 10th frame.
Very aggressive, and there you see the fingernails are coming off. You never trim your fingernails when you bowl on national television. You got to have something to chew on when you come down to that title match, don't you?
Trim the right hand, chew on the left. Or opposite if you're left-handed.
Words of advice from a man who has gone through that a few times.
At the six pin.
I love the way he shoots those spares. Very aggressive, right at him. Zips it right at him.
The most important frame of his young PBA career is coming up right now.
Mark, do you remember what went through your mind when you won your first PBA title?
I just wanted to throw some strikes that day.
Well, he shot 299 when he won his first PBA title.
Yeah, couldn't even shoot 300. Nice goal.
What can I say? First win, first 300. I'll take it.
And many more
for the win.
Ooh,
needs to make the seven pin.
Wow.
Boy, he threw it pretty though, didn't he?
Many Christmas. That's really the key to a great player, though, or potential, isn't it? When you need to strike to throw it that well.
Well, what happens if? Yes, it is. But in the match right now, if he misses this, Devers could strike out for a tie. So he must make this spare. Very little time. Hard. He's got it. That's it. He's the winner. He's won his first title.
And there's the handshake between friends. They started friends, they end as friends. But Parker Bohn III captures the $125,000 Columbia 300 Open, and this is a night he'll never forget.
So it's a different ball, the fill ball. One that didn't hook as much, obviously.
Didn't make a whole lot of difference, though, because he shoots a beautiful 224 game, and the best Scott Devers can do is 217. Doesn't make a whole lot of difference at this point. And
well, that was the I'm locked out of this, really don't care shot.
I know both of you gentlemen have been in that position where you bowled for titles, feel like you bowled pretty well, and you just didn't come up with enough.
Many times.
Well, Devers leaving the six pin in the sixth frame, seven pin in the eighth frame. Killed him. If he'd have made that, though, he'd have still had a chance coming into this frame.
And of course,
that seven pin.
Missing the seven pin really just took all the wind out of his sails. Yeah. In a title match, you just can't afford to make mistakes like that.
Well, I can remember back in 1983, I missed a 10 pin against Charlie Tapp, and boy, in a tight match. And when you do that, your opponent just says, adios.
Mm-hmm. Out here, the competition is so fierce. Most games were won and lost in the 10th frame. You open the door, and they'll walk right through it. Al Devers with an outstanding performance. We'll take home a check worth
$9,500. But there you see the winner of the $125,000 Columbia 300 Open, 23-year-old Parker Bohn III. And he relishes this moment, and it'll be shared with his family. As you can see, the hand still shaking just a little bit. There is the title board, 224 to 195. And he really bowled brilliantly here this evening.
Well, I think the people at home can get an idea why we say that he's got Future Star written all over him, and he's just waiting to burst out.
And we'll get a chance to chat with the champion right after this.
We're good friends, and we just wanted the best person to win. And apparently, the best person won.
Come on in, champion, Parker Bohn III. I guess that pretty much says it all. Sportsmanship, two fine young professionals. And Parker, your thoughts about winning your first career PBA title and having to defeat a friend in the process?
It was tough. He bowled a good game. Breaks could have went either way. You know, I'm just fortunate enough to be here now. I'm glad for both of us.
Now, you had a chance earlier on in the winter to perhaps come up a winner. Did you learn anything from that match? Did you carry anything over towards the title match this evening? You bowled superbly.
Just tried to relax, make good shots. You know, when I bowled in a winner, the title match, I was probably a little nervous and didn't make quite as crisp a shot as I would have liked to. And after those two shots on the left lane, I made a move and tried to make a good shot, and it worked.
Well, you sure threw a great shot, and here we'll see it. This is the one that pretty much, as Billy Whaley used to say, was daddy lockups. And it doesn't get much better than this. A heavy roll, as Mike Durbin described, with the fingers, clean release, and this is as flush as you can get. At that point in time, you pretty much had it figured you'd won your title.
Yes, I did. Once I got up, when Scott missed his spare, I was just saying to myself, try to make two real good shots in the ninth and tenth, and hopefully if they strike, fine. If they don't, just make the spare and come out of here a winner.
Well, I know you'll never forget this evening. Ron Herman, the president of Columbia Industries, now has a beautiful trophy and a nice check, I'm sure, to present.
Columbia 300 to participate in this wonderful tournament. It's always a pleasure to work with the PBA, the PBA staff, the PBA bowlers, and we especially want to congratulate the winner tonight. Present this beautiful trophy to Parker. Thank you.
Very nice.
Yeah, well said.
If I could, definitely, without a doubt, thank Mr. Ron Herman, president of Columbia Industries, for sponsoring this tournament. I hope he comes back again next year. Both of the proprietors here, Rod and Dave, they did a fine job, and all the scorekeepers, and especially you fans. We can't be here without all of yous. So thank you, everyone.